This is the great post office scandal, the fight to expose a multi-million pound IT disaster which put innocent people in jail. Published by Bath Publishing, written and read by Nick Wallis, with a foreword by Seema Misra, read by Aisha Darker.
I have always been a spiritual person. When I was convicted of theft in 2010, my faith and my belief in justice was shattered. I was pregnant at the time. My despair caused me to think of suicide. I wondered if God wanted me to have something in prison to worry about. Thoughts of my unborn child kept a bit of hope, and me, alive. The Hindu religion has a concept of Ram Rajya. That is, the realm of what Gandhi called the moral authority of the people. It is a realm in which peace, honesty, prosperity, and security prevail. I had come to England, like many, believing Britain was a place of Ram Rajya, which offered the opportunity to work, to thrive, and to prosper. In 2005, Davinder and I invested our own money in a post office branch and retail business. We were proud to have become part of such a famous British institution. When I was sentenced to prison on my eldest son's 10th birthday, all our dreams and hopes were destroyed. The post office did not quite get away with it. They almost did. It was reassuring and comforting to know that others believed something had gone wrong. They have kept the story alive when the post office very much wanted the story to die. Throughout our journey, we have made many wonderful friends who have been like lights in the darkness. Some have helped to restore a bit of faith in English justice. They never believed, even for one moment, that I was a thief. Reading this book made me cry. Nick brings to life what the post office did to me and to my family in a way that makes reading it feel like reliving it. It is a story which broke my heart. You may think it could never happen to you or to someone you love. This book shows that you would be wrong. It happened to me. Seema Misra, former West Byfleet sub-postmaster, July 2021.
Introduction. Seema Misra was sacked as sub-postmaster at the West Byfleet post office in Surrey and then charged with theft. A jury at Guildford Crown Court found her guilty of stealing £74,000 from her own post office. As Seema says in her foreword to this book, she was sentenced to jail for a crime she didn't commit on her eldest son's 10th birthday. When I met Davinder Misra, Seema's husband, Seema was still in prison. Davinder was adamant the case against her was wholly false. Seema, he told me, had been convicted on the basis of evidence from a faulty computer system called Horizon. It took more than 10 years for Davinder to be proved right. The Misras were not alone. In the first decade of this century, accounting evidence generated by the IT system at the heart of the post office branch network was being used to bring private prosecutions against counter staff and branch sub-postmasters on an industrial scale. Between 2000 and 2015, more than 700 people were given criminal convictions. Yet, the largest non-military IT system in Europe, as Horizon was proudly described, was riddled with bugs and coding errors. The post office, a government-owned company, was using the shaky electronic data produced by Horizon to wrongfully charge its own sub-postmasters with crimes which simply did not exist. Even if Horizon worked as it should, the sheer number of post office-led prosecutions during this 15-year period, more than one a week, should have raised eyebrows. But no one in the justice system or government seemed to be aware of what was going on. Worse still, when the post office realised it might have been responsible for unsafe prosecutions, it orchestrated a cover-up, hiding crucial information from MPs and campaigners. By 2020, enough detail had come to light for the MP Julian Lewis to describe the affair in Parliament as one of the worst disasters in public life since the infected blood scandal. Despite this, no one has been held responsible. Not a single person has been officially censured or blamed for the misery heaped on so many lives. Over the last decade or so, I've spoken to countless sub-postmasters, post office workers, politicians, union officials, lawyers, IT experts, accountants, and fraud investigators. I've spent hundreds of hours digging through transcripts, parliamentary inquiry evidence, audit reports, and court documents. I've also met dozens of innocent people who were criminally prosecuted by the post office, some of whom, like Seema, were sent to prison. They were put at the mercy of an organisation stuffed with managerial incompetence who exercised their responsibilities with a toxic mixture of prejudice and indifference. The great post office scandal is an attempt to unravel exactly what went wrong and determine who's to blame. It also documents the heroics of those who fought long and hard against a powerful and well-resourced opponent to get the truth into the public domain. It's quite a story. Part 1. Building an Empire. Clint parked up outside the low-rise glass and concrete office block situated on the edge of Hanworth Park in Hounslow. He announced himself at reception and collected an ID pass. As he waited to be accompanied into the building, he reflected on what he'd been told about the project he'd soon be getting a direct handle on. He knew it was in trouble, that's why he was there. How much trouble, he could not begin to imagine. The late 90s were a good time to be in IT. The globally connected future, foretold by wide-eyed seers and digital visionaries, was no longer the stuff of fantasy. The dot-com boom was, well, booming, and the information superhighway, or World Wide Web, was becoming part of everyday life. Smartphones, Google and Facebook were still a while off, but dial-up modems, Netscape and email had worked their way into Britain's businesses and homes. Empires need construction workers, and jobs were easy to come by. The IT world was full of brilliant minds, but there were plenty of chances talking themselves into jobs they weren't qualified to do. Coders, testers and systems and network engineers were all in demand, alongside the usual project managers, sales and marketing people. There were also plenty of middle-ranking execs with little understanding of what the young Turks in their charge were up to, but had learned just about enough to bluff their way through. Clint was no chancer. Clint was the real deal. He'd been working in IT development his entire career. He knew how to code a system, and he knew how to manage a team. After spending most of the 90s in Brussels developing complex financial systems for the European Parliament and European Commission, Clint had been called by a former colleague who was working on a project to automate the post office network. The project's name was Horizon. Tracy Felstead. In November 1999, 17-year-old Tracy Felstead nervously stepped through the door of her local Crown Post Office in Camberwell Green, South London. She was young, keen, just out of school, and had been invited to an interview for the post of counter assistant. Luckily, Tracy had been recommended to the branch manager by a family friend, and the interview went well. She was offered and accepted the job. Tracy was sent on a 2-day training course to learn her way around Horizon, the new computerised till system which hadn't long been installed in the branch. Soon Tracy was using it to serve customers. There were 12 counter positions at Camberwell Green. Tracy was the youngest assistant, so she was taken under the wing of the experienced staff. To be fair, everybody seemed lovely, she remembers. Everybody seemed pretty much on the ball. If you needed any help, you could just ask. Each member of staff had their own login, allowing them to switch between counters, but the regime was lax. No one minded if you used somebody else's login. If somebody needed a break during a busy period, another member of staff would jump on their Horizon terminal without going through the process of logging off and logging back in again. This ensured minimum disruption for customers, but it had obvious security implications. Every day, after each shift, Tracy would cash up, checking the money in her till tray against the figures on the Horizon screen. She'd then print off and sign a receipt displaying the till tray balance. One day, she found herself with a small deficit, Tracy said her manager was not in the least bit concerned. I think because I was the baby, all of them mothered me. She said, oh, it's fine, it'll rectify itself. I suppose I was a bit naive, being 17, but I trusted her. Tracy was a happy girl and a popular employee. She flew through the hectic pre-Christmas period without any serious mishaps. Her understanding of her responsibilities, handling cash, handling Horizon, and handling customers, was coming on in leaps and bounds. Outside work, Tracy was getting serious with her partner John, who worked as a reprographics manager in the city. They bought a house in Penge and were planning to get married. Life was all set. Halfway through 2000, Tracy suffered another spate of discrepancies. I did a cash-up at the end of the week, and I had a £1,300 loss, she says. Again, her boss seemed relaxed. Tracy said the manager took over at the terminal, did something, and the loss went up to £1,800. And then she said, oh, leave it, I'll sort it out. Tracy did leave it, but she was concerned. In February 2001, Tracy locked her till tray in the office safe and went on a family holiday. It was her parents' 15th wedding anniversary, so they chose somewhere special, the Dominican Republic. While Tracy was away, her cash tray could be used by someone else, so long as all the stock and cash was checked before and after each session, and the counter assistant entered the figures under their own login into Horizon. The day before Tracy got back from holiday, a loss of £11,503.28 was found on her stock unit. On her return to work, Tracy was questioned about the loss. Her manager's demeanour was not motherly anymore. I'm looking at this woman like, what on earth is going on? And she said, oh, another member of staff used the till while you were away and found a discrepancy. Tracy was asked if she knew how the discrepancy had come about. She remembers shaking her head and firmly telling her manager she had no idea. The next day, Tracy cashed up and signed off her stock units with the £11,000 discrepancy still outstanding. There appeared to be a serious amount of money missing from Tracy's till position. But as nothing more was said about it, she put it to the back of her mind. Tracy continued serving customers, but the atmosphere had changed. 2 weeks later, she walked into work and was given a shock. I've got two strapping, great big guys sitting there waiting for me, and they want to interview me. And I said, OK, that's absolutely fine. They asked whether I wanted legal representation, and I told them, no, I haven't done anything wrong, so I don't need anybody. Happy to be interviewed, not a problem. The two strapping guys were from the post office's internal security unit. Tracy's interview turned into an interrogation. They were constantly asking, what did you spend the money on? And I remember looking at them saying, seriously, I haven't taken any money. You can have access to anything you want, bank accounts, whatever. I haven't taken any money. Tracy was suspended. They said they needed to do some more investigation. I was distraught, absolutely distraught. But part of me actually thought, well, they'll get me sorted because I haven't stolen any money, so they'll fix this. 3 weeks later, at 8 a.m, the same post office investigators knocked on the door of John's parents' home in Peckham, where Tracy was staying. The investigators were accompanied by two police officers. The police told me they were there to keep the peace. What they thought I was going to do, I'm not quite sure. I'm only 5'3" and small, you know, a size 10. And I'm not going to... These men are massive, intimidating, huge men. And they said, could you escort us down the police station for interviewing? And I said, yeah, fine. On this occasion, Tracy did ask for a solicitor. The magic bullet. The full automation of post office systems was set in motion in 1992, initially as part of a solution to rampant fraud. In those days, benefits were paid at the post office by exchanging vouchers from social security order books for cash. Between 1991 and 1992, £230 million worth of order books were lost, of which £85 million had been found to be fraudulently cashed. A further £16 million was lost through fraudulent encashment of gyro cheques. The paper system was vulnerable, and needed upgrading. After a few experiments with barcoded audiobooks, the Department of Social Security decided it wanted to use a magnetic strip swipe card as a vehicle for dispensing benefits payments. The cards would be given to claimants who would have their use of the card electronically registered at a central database each time they were swiped at a post office. This ensured each card could only be used once a week and deactivated if lost. Swipe cards were an established technology. The problem was, the post office had nowhere to swipe them. For decades, the post office had been the place where British citizens did their admin with the state. Each day, millions of people would visit their local branch to buy stamps, tax discs, travellers' cheques, premium bonds, or TV licences. They would cash benefits and pensions, or make utility bill payments, National Savings Bank account withdrawals or deposits, or apply for passports or driving, fishing or game licences, or any number of other permits and services. Important documents were stamped, signed, shown or submitted, and cash would be paid or received accordingly. These transactions, made in their millions every day, gave the post office a multi-billion pound annual turnover. It was an established system, and it worked. But it was costly. Although attempts had been made to automate various parts of the network, by the mid-90s, most village and suburban branches were still handing over paper forms, stamping dockets, transferring physical cash, and generally operating more or less along the same lines they had in Queen Victoria's day, especially when it came to filing branch accounts. At the end of each trading week, every sub-postmaster would fill out a giant paper spreadsheet, recording their transactions in the relevant designated column. The sheet would be signed, folded, and posted back to the post office's financial headquarters in Chesterfield. By the 1990s, this antiquated system was in need of an overhaul. With the race for digitisation happening everywhere, the post office, government and many sub-postmasters felt that automating the post office network was a nettle which needed to be grasped. The DSS swipe card idea provided the impetus for starting to wrestle with the eye-watering cost and logistics of doing so. The eventual solution was a £1 billion private finance initiative, or PFI, contract. This was tendered in 1994 by both the DSS-owned benefits agency and the post office. It would deliver the swipe card scheme and automate the front and back end of Britain's 20,000 post offices. A transformative project. The candidates were whittled down to a shortlist of three. In May 1996, the winner was announced. Pathway, a consortium owned almost entirely by a company called International Computers Limited, better known as ICL, got the gig. ICL once saw itself as Britain's answer to the American computing giant IBM, but its glory days were long gone. In 1990, the Japanese tech corp Fujitsu had taken an 80% stake in ICL with a view to outright ownership. Whilst Pathway was being tendered, Fujitsu was in the process of swallowing ICL whole. Pathway managed to come bottom in 8 of the 11 scoring criteria drawn up to quantify the strengths of each bid, but it was the cheapest in terms of its cost to the government. Fujitsu's business model for Pathway saw it shouldering almost all the project's commercial risk by paying for its development and rollout. In return, Pathway would get a transaction fee every time a shiny new benefits agency card was swiped through a shiny new post office card swiper, for a guaranteed period of 8 years. If all went according to plan, Project Pathway would deliver automation of the post office and vast sums of cash to Fujitsu without any risk to the public purse. As an incentive to get things operational as soon as possible, the 8-year guaranteed transaction fee period would start the moment the PFI deal was signed. Almost as soon as the ink on the contract was dry, Pathway ran into difficulties. Serious, big-picture difficulties. It seemed everyone had badly underestimated the complexity of automating 20,000 geographically isolated and disparate post offices carrying out multiple and sometimes region-specific transactions, which were many times more complicated than the average bank. The logistics of building, testing, and installing a bespoke IT system of this size was uncharted territory for the government and Fujitsu. 20,000 post offices would need 40,000 terminals. 67,000 people with various technical skills would have to be trained to successfully keep handing out £56 billion in benefits alone to their 28 million annual customers. The hardware would have to be robust. The software would have to process millions of transactions a year. Training and support would have to be first rate. Fujitsu had bid for IT's Operation Moonshot by undercutting the competition. Having won the contract, they were realising how complex and expensive moonshots can be. Conceptually, Horizon was relatively straightforward. The front-end terminals would be custom-specced PCs running Microsoft's Windows NT operating system. These would sit in a box under each post office counter window. Each PC would be connected to a custom keyboard, a barcode scanner, a 3.5-inch receipts printer, and a touchscreen, which would sit on top of the counter. Running bespoke Horizon software, each counter PC would write both manually and barcode-inputted transactions into the branch accounts. Every night, all the information collected from the branch would be uploaded via ISDN, or in some cases satellite, to a centrally located post office mainframe. That was the theory. Writing the code to make this system work reliably appeared to be completely beyond Fujitsu. Despite burning through £10 million a month, by the middle of 1997, Fujitsu was not able to deliver an already renegotiated contractual obligation to demonstrate Horizon's satisfactory, sustained operation. Even in a controlled environment, they simply could not get it to work. Fujitsu was not helped by its clients, two state-owned entities with different and sometimes competing priorities. Goalposts for the project were constantly being moved. Fujitsu would later tell Parliament that over 3 years, Pathway's 366 original contractual requirements had been subject to 323 formal change requests by the Post Office and the Benefits Agency. This was exacerbated, it said, by numerous informal changes and clarifications, which necessitated significant system redesign. Frustrated with the delays, in December 1997, the Benefits Agency and the Post Office served Fujitsu with a formal notice of breach of contract. Fujitsu, fed up with the way it was being treated, refused to accept the notice. It then upped the ante by threatening to stop work on the Horizon project altogether unless it received a guaranteed hike in the fee it was going to get from each swipe of the DSS benefits card. The standoff turned critical when the Benefits Agency responded by announcing it no longer wished to use swipe cards to dispense benefits payments. Instead, it was going to encourage claimants to have their benefits delivered direct to their bank accounts. In one swoop, Fujitsu's potential income from the project had been reduced to zero. On top of that, the post office was looking at losing a third of its customer base overnight. In January 1998, serious consideration was given to abandoning Horizon altogether. But the project limped on. Despite a shifting brief and its lack of operability, there was a feeling in Whitehall that Horizon had become too expensive to kill. Someone was going to have to find a way through, because the fallout caused by cancelling the project would be politically disastrous. Leaping Antelopes. When Clint joined Fujitsu in April 1998, he was vaguely aware of the political wrangling going on around the Horizon project, but it was of no real concern to him. His job was to find out what was stopping Horizon from working and fix it. More than 20 years later, after a couple of lengthy telephone conversations, I travelled to meet Clint for lunch at the Grand Hotel in York. Clint had got in touch with me using a messaging app, but was something of a terse communicator when it came to email. I was keen to ensure that before I made the trip, he understood the terms on which we were meeting, to record an interview about his experiences at Fujitsu. I also needed some documentation from him. He seemed cagey, but genuine. I was prepared to take a punt. I got on a commuter train to London, crossed the city to King's Cross, and then travelled to York in a near-empty train carriage, a tiny bit unsure as to whether Clint was going to turn up. I needn't have worried. Clint arrived bang on time, and produced enough paperwork to prove he was indeed who he said he was. I found him to be a blunt-speaking individual who's keen to keep his identity private. Over lunch, he opened up about his experience of working on Horizon. Clint, as you may have already guessed, is not his real name. Everybody in the building by the time I got there knew it was a bag of shit, he told me. Everybody. Because it had gone through the test labs God knows how many times, and the testers were raising bugs by the thousand, including Category A's. Software code is written by human beings who make mistakes. Computer bugs are errors mistakenly written by developers into lines of software code which tell electronic devices what to do. One misplaced character can make a computer do the wrong thing, or set off a chain of routines and subroutines which could lead to something very serious happening. This is why software code needs to be tested in a variety of different environments, almost to destruction, before it can be let loose in the wild. If it's not properly written or properly tested, your computer will crash, and sometimes in extreme circumstances, so will the planes reliant on it. During testing and operation, the problems bugs create are traditionally classified according to severity. Category C is okay, category B is serious, and category A means the system might be unusable. Clint told me Horizon, when he first encountered it, was infested. There were thousands, thousands of bugs in the system. You could not see for leaping antelopes, and a lot of them were A's and B's. Clint's initial role was undefined. My manager knew enough about computers to realise he was in the shit, so when he saw I came from a technical background and how much experience I had, he just said, "Go in there and find out what the developers are doing." Clint said what he saw was not pretty. They had a team of 8 developers who were some of the worst people I've ever seen. There were a couple of good lads in there who knew how to code properly and were interested in learning and having a properly structured development project. But the rest, it was just... it was like kindergarten. They didn't know, they weren't interested in knowing, and it was just about filling their pockets with money and going home at the end of the day. It seemed to Clint that some managers didn't know the difference between a good developer and a bad developer because they weren't developers themselves. This included the former post office man who'd been put in charge of developing Horizon's electronic point of sale, known as an EPOS system, the front-end terminal which would sit inside each post office branch recording the transactions. Clint was aghast. He didn't have any experience, to my knowledge, in running a development team, writing code, how to make sure the guys knew what they were doing, recruiting the right people, putting them in the right place, system testing, volume testing, any of this stuff that you really need to be doing in a development team. He was, according to Clint, in the wrong job. He was a post office guy. He should have been there as a business advisor, and they should have had a proper development manager in charge of running that development team. There were no specs getting written, there was no development controls going on, there was no design written down, there was nothing. Clint told me that after spending a few weeks trying to properly understand the project, he had a decent handle on most of the problems. He reckoned Horizon's third-party touchscreen interface software worked well, but the code behind the touchscreen buttons, written in a mixture of 3 programming languages, Visual Basic, C and C++, was not good. The biggest problem, however, was the information being written to something called a message store. The Riposte message store was a powerful piece of third-party software within the Horizon system, containing some of its fundamental operating instructions. Riposte also functioned to ensure the important financial data being inputted was safely transferred and duplicated to off-site mainframe storage computers. The first thing that you should always do with a system like that, said Clint, is design and agree a data dictionary and a message library repository, basically to say, these are the messages that are allowed to be written to the message store and they all provide the following function. Clint continued. It's almost like an API, a programming interface, so that you have a list of allowed messages, agreed messages, which can all be written to the correct format with the correct content. You should also have a layer of software that lies on top of the message store, which checks any application above it that's trying to write a message conforms to the agreed data dictionary. Otherwise, you can just write freestyle to the message store, which is what they were doing. There was no application interface in there, no agreed data catalogue or anything. According to Clint, Horizon's developers had spent the last couple of years firing any old shit into the message store as they changed and developed the product. Clint explained that this was a recipe for disaster. If a message was given a new data field, but this wasn't retrospectively applied, the counter software could retrieve an old message with what it would now perceive to be a missing data field. The reaction of the application would be unpredictable. It could crash, it could send the wrong information to the wrong place unnoticed. It could cause the wrong values to be applied to a transaction. It could cause values to halve, or double, or multiply. Knowing exactly what code is in your system is essential. If the application's not checking that the contents are correct, which they weren't because they weren't writing them properly, then the message store is completely corrupted with garbage, Clint told me. This meant the software had no integrity. It was unreliable. I wondered how this could have happened. It was a question Clint was asking himself at the time. He said that from talking to people around the project, he gathered the Horizon software at the EPOS end was originally written by a small nucleus of people as a prototype to show what a riposte-based counter system might look like. It was this which won them the contract. And what you should do when you get the contract, Clint said, is throw the prototype away and start from the beginning, because all that prototype is proof of concept. The architect's cardboard model. You don't start putting roof tiles on the cardboard building, which is exactly what they were doing. Having reviewed the whole EPOS side of the Horizon project and tested his theories with some developers he trusted, Clint says he went back to his bosses with a few home truths. I broke it down and said, you can keep these bits at a push if you have to, but that bit in the middle, these bits of the engine, the gearbox, you need to throw them away and rebuild them, starting with the cache account. You've got to throw the cache account away and you've got to rewrite it. The cache account wasn't an account in the traditional sense of the word. It was a program which crawled through every transaction on each Horizon terminal in each branch at the end of the day's trading. It then came up with a figure which should correspond exactly with the amount of physical cash on the premises. That figure was then automatically uploaded to the post office's central servers overnight. It's a relatively simple task to describe, but not necessarily to execute. Given its central importance to the financial integrity of the Horizon system, it had to be bulletproof. It wasn't. The code was not good enough. Clint told his bosses at Fujitsu the cache account had to be completely scrapped and rebuilt from scratch. They refused his request, saying it would take too long and cost too much. He was told to repair it. Clint told me he convened and ran a team of hand-picked developers who did what they could, before internal politics saw him shifted to working on the back end of the Horizon project. I listened to Clint with rising levels of alarm. When he'd finished, I asked him to sum Horizon up. Without hesitation, he replied, it was a prototype that had been bloated and hacked together afterwards for several years and then pushed, screaming and kicking, out of the door. It should never have seen the light of day. Never. Over the first 6 months of 1999, while Clint was still there, Horizon's PFI contract was reorganised once more. The benefits agency, having almost fatally holed the project with its decision to take swipe cards off the table, walked away completely. The government decided Horizon would become the post office's baby. Fujitsu, which had written off £180 million on the project and hadn't yet worked out how it was going to get it back, would continue to develop Horizon on a fixed payment basis. A subsequent National Audit Office report estimated the botched procurement had wasted £500 million of government money. So much for Fujitsu shouldering nearly all of the risk. Once the decision had been made by government, the post office's IT and business impact teams were understandably concerned about taking responsibility for Horizon. They wanted the opportunity to test it properly before it went anywhere near the post office estate, a word regularly used to describe either the post office system's networks and or its physical estate, including Crown and sub-post offices and its administrative buildings. On the 4th of March 1999, the Post Office's Horizon Programme Board examined the risks associated with the project. It scored them up to 25, multiplying their impact value by their probability value, and graded them green, amber, and red. Anything over 15 was a red. The first five risks listed were all red. All of them were scored at the maximum 25. The authors wrote, "Due to the lack of adequate visibility of the ICL pathway, read Horizon, design, and the lack of support from the contract to leverage this visibility, we have been unable to gain a high level of assurance in the adequacy or suitability of the service." Under action, it rather desperately states, "All other approaches having failed, final entreaty has been made for cooperation from pathway, read Fujitsu, to make available appropriate level of documentation." Fujitsu saw this concern from their clients as yet more interference, which could lead to yet more changes and yet more cost. Also, they still couldn't get Horizon to work. Fujitsu put up a shield of commercial confidentiality, citing the terms of the PFI project, and shut everyone out. Behind that shield, Fujitsu's developers, testers, and engineers feverishly bashed their new IT system into something that looked like it might work. Although Horizon was clearly not ready to go live, in July 1999, the government announced the post office would start its switch to full automation in October the same year. A joint working group was convened. Base units, touchscreens, and keyboards were bought and specced up. Teams were hired. A live trial began. Margaret Davison's post office in West Boldon was one of the branches selected for the trial. In a short but vivid memoir written long after her retirement in 2006, Margaret describes what it was like. "The installation took place over some days when a constant stream of electricians, post office staff and computer geeks climbed or sat all around my office while I tried to keep my counter and business running. Looking back, I wonder how I retain my sanity or my strength. There were so many faults in the system which you were expected to cope with, learning on your feet with a queue of customers in front of you. Not to mention helpline staff so inexperienced and under pressure, it often took an hour to get a call to them answered. How I avoided a nervous breakdown at the age of 60 in a one-position, very busy little village post office, I do not know. From day one, the system was flawed." In August 1999, 2 months before the project would go live, a post office business impact analysis of Horizon listed six high-severity problems, including one which said TIP, which stands for Transaction Information Processing, derived cash account not equal to electronic cash account received by TIP. In other words, the cash account Clint was so exercised about still didn't work. Under business impact, the report's authors wrote that the post office has not seen a detailed description of the faults creating the missing data, neither has it seen any description of how and when these faults will be fixed. The effect was clear. These gaps in data will ultimately be reflected in balance sheet accounts. The seriousness of the situation was underscored by the startling revelation that Fujitsu had admitted to the report's authors that they do not yet understand the root cause of the problem. Other high-severity problems included back-end data losses causing accounting discrepancies, transactions being lost before they could even be written to the cash account, system freezes and lockups, printer failures, and general losses of accounting integrity. It is perhaps no surprise that in September 1999, the Post Office Board refused to sign off the project, noting serious doubts over the reliability of the software. Yet a month later, in October 1999, the minutes note, "Following the remedial work around two issues which had previously prevented acceptance, the system has now been accepted, with implementation proceeding at a rate of 200 offices per week." How Horizon's serious system problems could be fixed to the satisfaction of the Post Office Board so quickly and conveniently is a mystery. The document, presentation, or written assurance which gave them this comfort has not yet been made public. Nevertheless, the board had signed it off, rollout was underway, and Horizon would soon be wreaking its havoc across the post office network. The first government agency. To understand how the Horizon scandal could happen, it's worth trying to understand what the post office actually is. If you have spent any time in the UK, you're likely to have some sort of concept of the post office. Depending on where you live, and possibly how old you are, that concept will vary. The image of a middle-aged husband and wife team running a village branch as their last job before retirement still just about holds true. But the network has changed significantly over the last 20 years. There are now hundreds of busy suburban outlets in the hands of limited companies or entrepreneurial sub-postmasters with multiple branches seeking profit in economies of scale. In recent years, the post office has also retreated from many of its imposing city centre Crown Office buildings and chosen instead to inhabit the basements and back ends of newsagents and stationery chains. Unfortunately, a down-at-heel shabbiness characterises many post offices. In 2018, the journalist Patrick Collinson wrote an article for The Guardian entitled "How Did We Allow Our Post Offices to Become So Grotty?" You only have to drive by a few urban branches in large cities to see what he means. Yet the post office still holds, and undoubtedly trades off, a unique position in the British psyche. In the alleyway behind my house, there's a wooden telegraph pole. Carved into the pole at just about head height are the initials GPO. This stands for General Post Office, a brand which predates the Industrial Revolution, the British Empire, and indeed Britain, which came into being with the Acts of Union between Scotland and England in 1707. There's been a master of the post since Henry VIII's time, and in 1660, Charles II approved an act for erecting and establishing a post office, which created the role of Postmaster General and one general post office so that speedy and safe dispatches may be had. The General Post Office formally survived as a directly controlled government department until 1969. But the post office isn't just old. It's everywhere. During the 1800s, the post office's activities grew exponentially on the back of huge railway expansion, democratising long-distance communication and accelerating Britain's capacity to conduct business between its great cities. 19th and 20th century developments in telecommunications, telegrams and then telephones, were monopolised by the GPO, which required thousands of operators and engineers to keep these new technologies going. By 1936, the post office, along with its glamorous liveried sub-brand, the Royal Mail, was the largest employer in the country, with 250,000 staff. The post office as a concept is therefore more than just a retail presence on the high street. It can legitimately be said to be the oldest government agency, and at least until recently, the main physical interface between the British state and its citizens. Even now, post office paraphernalia retains certain romantic associations, which are bound up with concepts of national identity. Think about images of penny blacks, post boxes, mail trains, switchboard operators, postcards and telegrams. The apparatus of the network state has been lionised in poetry, literature, film and television. More often than not, they were presented as symbols of British greatness, representing notions of trust, efficiency, stability and security. But the post office's eternal presence has been preserved by something with an altogether more sinister edge. As well as being part of the fabric of the nation, the efficient and secure operation of the post office is protected by its proximity to power. Interrupting or defrauding post office business comes with severe penalties. For most of the last three centuries, the post office has maintained a specialised investigative unit. This unit has direct access to the criminal justice system through the post office's in-house prosecutors. In fact, the post office investigation branch, known by the start of the 20th century as IB, is the oldest recognised criminal investigation force in the world. It predates the police. In the 18th and 19th centuries, postal workers caught stealing from the mail could expect to be hanged. The Post Office Museum website proudly states that the investigation branch has worked to detect offences against the post and prosecute the perpetrators. These could be highwaymen, robbers, clerks or delivery boys, or even spies. During the 20th century, IB personnel worked with the security services to identify mail sent by internal subversives. When suspicious letters reached Royal Mail sorting offices, they would be picked up by IB security staff and taken to the first floor of the post office's headquarters in St Martin's Le Grand, near St Paul's Cathedral. Here, technicians would carefully open the letters to photograph the contents. The photographs were passed to government spooks. The letters were carefully resealed and dropped back into the system, with their intended recipients none the wiser. In addition, whilst the GPO had responsibility for the nation's phone lines, the Post Office Investigation Branch supplied the security services with phone taps. This creepy element to the Post Office's activities wound down as perceived post-war and Cold War threats to the internal stability of the nation dissipated. In 1969, the Office of Postmaster General was abolished and the GPO ceased to exist as a brand. Though the Post Office and Royal Mail remained state-owned, with a monopoly on the business of shifting letters from one part of the country to another. In the latter half of the 20th century, IB went through various reorganisations, first becoming an investigations division, then a department. By the 80s, it had largely ceded its external investigative activities to the police and was focusing its attention and resources on the internal activities of Royal Mail, Post Office and Parcel Force staff. There were thousands of people within the Post Office network who came into daily contact with large volumes of mail and tempting wads of notes at sorting offices, cash centres and post office branches around the country. They needed to be watched. By all accounts, the Post Office Investigations Department, with more than its fair share of burly ex-coppers, was something of a law unto itself. POID had the authority to interview staff under caution. As with its historical predecessors, if POID believed a criminal offence had taken place, instead of handing everything over to the police or the newly formed Crown Prosecution Service, post office investigators passed their evidence to the post office's own in-house prosecutors, who would bring charges directly. In the 1990s, the department was renamed POSIS, Post Office Security and Investigation Services, and then finally Security Group. By 2010, when the post office's prosecution frenzy was still in full swing, Royal Mail Group, which had turned the tables on its older sibling and now counted the post office as one of its sub-brands, employed 287 investigators and security managers. A five-page document informing the public about the activities of RMG security stated bluntly, "Those who steal must expect to be detected and prosecuted." The process of calling in the heavies when suspicions were raised about nefarious activities at a post office branch varied. In a Crown office, it was relatively straightforward. A branch manager would spot or be informed about suspected criminal activity and refer that information directly to the security team. Things were a little different when it came to the post office's network of sub-postmasters. This is because sub-postmasters are not, and never have been, post office staff. They are small business owners acting as agents for the post office. Every sub-postmaster is security checked before being appointed. They are, as a rule, unlikely to be dishonest. But there are thousands of sub-postmasters employing tens of thousands of counter-assistants. Billions of pounds in cash washed through the post office network on a monthly basis. Criminal activity at some level, by someone, is a given. Detecting and stopping it is another matter altogether. Pre-Horizon, once a tranche of cash had been received by a branch from a post office cash centre, the post office essentially lost sight of it, becoming wholly reliant on the weekly filed accounts to know where it had gone. Close monitoring of what was happening in any one of the post office's 20,000-plus branches was impossible. There was no CCTV or electronic data collection. Almost everything was done on trust. The only way of knowing if a sub-postmaster's filed accounts had any bearing on reality was by paying them a visit. This was done by the post office's UK-wide squad of auditors, who would descend on a branch without warning, lock the door, and conduct a full stocktake and cash count, with the sub-postmaster present. Auditors chose which branch to visit either at random, on the basis of a tip-off, or if someone in Chesterfield had flagged something alarming. If everything was in order, the auditors would leave, and the branch could reopen. If a small amount of money was missing, the sub-postmaster would be required to make it good before being allowed to reopen. Some kind of warning might be issued. If a large amount of money was missing, the sub-postmaster would be suspended by their local contract manager, and the security team's feared investigators would be summoned. It was a rather agricultural approach, but right up until the end of the 20th century, it was all the post office had. Horizon was going to be the post office's big bang. Instead of being in the dark about what was going on in their thousands of branches, every transaction put through every post office till in the country would now be recorded and downloaded onto the post office's central servers every night. A window onto the activities of sub-postmasters and their assistants had been opened. The lights had come on. Rolling out Horizon. CEO Losrab is a former technical lead at Fujitsu, responsible for the live rollout of Horizon. I found his details on social media and thought it was worth chancing my arm to see if he was willing to be interviewed for this book. Being an amiable chap, he saw no reason why not. It was fascinating to have a lengthy chat with someone who had the job of introducing Horizon to hundreds of sub-postmasters across the country. Unfortunately, due to the coronavirus pandemic, we couldn't meet in person. "I thought Horizon was state-of-the-art," CO told me, when we finally got our Zoom link working. "I actually really liked the solution, and the hardware we were delivering was quite high spec. I mean, it didn't run so well, but that's because it was being asked to do so much, but it was very forward-thinking." It was CO's job to help sub-postmasters make sense of Horizon, both as a piece of kit and as a concept. "It was really daunting to the older generation," CO told me. "Some of them just weren't ready for it. One guy was selling postcards in his shop, and I said to him, 'You see all these individual postcards? Each one of these could be a holiday that you could sell through Horizon.' But he couldn't grasp it. He called it a sledgehammer to crack a nut." CEO had a team of installers who would help sub-postmasters switch from paper accounts to touchscreen data entry, working with them to patiently input their existing figures into Horizon, and holding their hands as they came to terms with this brave new world. There were plenty of sub-postmasters who welcomed the arrival of the new IT system, but a few found it genuinely terrifying. CEO recalled one old dear who went to press her new Horizon touchscreen with her finger shaking, bless her. "I felt really sorry for her. But we never rushed anybody. We gave her as much time as she needed to make her comfortable and make sure she was all right." Even so, CO admits there was a problem from the start. "Yeah, there was incompatibility there with the older generation." What is a sub-postmaster? Today, the terms postmaster and sub-postmaster are used interchangeably. They describe exactly the same job. This is a recent conflation. The role of head postmaster, distinct from a sub-postmaster, survived well into the 1980s. In the 19th century, there was a clear hierarchical divide between the two. Head postmasters were regional appointees of the Postmaster General, responsible for the receipt and distribution of the entire mail operation in a given area. Sub-postmasters were an altogether less fortunate breed. Unlike head postmasters, sub-postmasters were not employed by the post office. Their role attracted no pension, holiday, or sick pay. They were self-employed, and on their appointment were expected to install their post office counter and telegraph communications fixtures at their own expense. In Queen Victoria's time, they received no extra allowance for working Sundays, or up to 12 hours on Christmas Day, and often found the cost of running a branch outweighed its income. In short, postmasters, full-time members of post office staff, were the haves. Sub-postmasters were the have-nots. There was also a not-so-subtle class distinction at work. Within the post office, postmasters were seen and treated as maybe not quite gentlemen, after all, they work for a living, but an altogether better sort of person, going about the Queen's business in service of their country and empire. Sub-postmasters were traders, shopkeepers, lower-middle-class sorts opportunistically seeking to improve their social standing by association with a national institution. Sub-postmasters were accepted by the post office hierarchy on sufferance, mainly because their contribution to a functioning network was essential, but they were never quite trusted or embraced. In 1896, Joseph Rams, a stationer living in Wakefield, wrote, "I was desirous of the appointment as sub-postmaster in the belief that to have employment from the government was a direct road to success in commercial life." Rams' application succeeded, but he soon discovered it wasn't everything it was cracked up to be. "I was doing the work of a sub-postmaster," he wrote, "and paying for the privilege, as the working expenses of the office were decidedly more than the income from all sources." This was not sustainable. In 1897, aggrieved sub-postmasters led by Rams formed a trade association, the National Federation of Sub-Postmasters. Campaigns, threatened strikes, and wider social advances led to some improvements in working conditions, but the lot of a sub-postmaster in the first half of the 20th century was not a happy one. In the 1950s, after substantial lobbying, the government awarded sub-postmasters a series of salary increases. For the first time, it was just about possible to make a living. The hours were long, and you had to be a savvy retailer, but there were perks. You had a government stipend, your retail business got plenty of footfall, and as a holder of public office, you became a visible and respected pillar of your local community. Throughout the technological and retail revolutions of the 70s and 80s, branch sub-post offices barely changed. So long as their biggest client, the government, kept putting business their way, for example, pensions, tax discs, housing benefit, social security stamps, and as long as that gave the general public an incentive to regularly visit their local post office, which it did, a sub-postmaster could make a living. During the latter part of the 20th century, the National Federation of Sub-Postmasters seemed to spend a lot of their lobbying efforts resisting initiatives which could take government business away from their members. To run a profitable business, sub-postmasters needed to be the middleman between state and citizen. On many occasions, trading on their central importance to the high street, they won the argument with both politicians and the public. Despite this, and despite the official abolition of head postmasters at the end of the 20th century, the post office's cultural snobbery towards and lack of trust in their sub-postmasters never quite disappeared. While sub-postmasters were treated like employees and given some of the benefits employees might enjoy, including a guaranteed salary, the post office took the view that contractually, sub-postmasters were business agents, operating sub-post offices as franchises. This is legally set down in the document which underpins the relationship between a sub-postmaster and the post office, the sub-postmaster's contract. It spells out exactly what is expected of a sub-postmaster in return for the privilege of having a sub-post office. It is completely non-negotiable. The contract makes clear the extent to which the office of sub-postmaster is in the gift of the post office. Once bestowed, it can be removed for any perceived infraction or transferred to a more deserving candidate on receipt of 3 months' notice. A sub-postmaster is in a position of responsibility and therefore has to abide by strict rules. The sub-postmaster's contract makes it clear the post office has the right to query, audit, or investigate a sub-postmaster's branch at any time. The most notorious clause in the sub-postmaster's contract is Section 12, Responsibility for Post Office Stock and Cash, Clause 12, Losses. It states, The sub-postmaster is responsible for all losses caused through his own negligence, carelessness or error, and also for losses of all kinds caused by his assistants. Deficiencies due to such losses must be made good without delay. The post office took this to mean that if a sub-postmaster had a negative discrepancy in their accounts and could not prove it was not caused by their negligence, carelessness or error, it was on them. The clause also meant that if a sub-postmaster's assistant messed up or looted the safe, it was on the sub-postmaster too. Section 1212 was designed as a clear contractual incentive to make sure each sub-postmaster ran a tight ship, employed the right assistants, and trained them well. On the day sub-postmasters took control of their branches, it was expected they would sign their contract in situ, along with the Official Secrets Act and several other legally binding documents. The contents of these documents were often a mystery to both the incoming sub-postmaster and the post office contract manager who proffered them. Sub-postmasters often had no idea what they were signing up to, and even if they asked, were unlikely to get a sensible answer. The sub-postmasters who went into business with the post office tended to be bright and diligent, proud to work for a national institution with an illustrious history. Before applying to run a branch, many sub-postmasters had successful careers and led innocuous and blameless lives. Some had been police officers or served in the military. Others were done with being middle managers in large businesses. Most had built up a modest nest egg and were looking to invest in a solid proposition as their last job before retirement. Another typical group already ran small retail businesses and were looking to invest their savings into a brand which would bring them more visibility and footfall. You might think anyone who doesn't read a contract before they sign it is an idiot. But it comes down to how well you understand the risks involved and the consequences of something going wrong. Downloading an app onto your phone might require giving it permission to access your address book, location, camera, microphone, operating system, and personal details. This carries a significant risk, but most of us don't even read the legally binding agreement which comes with the app. We just tick the box without any idea what the app developer intends to do with the access we've just granted it. This is because we think whatever could happen won't happen to us. Or even if it does, the outcome won't be catastrophic, because we can probably rely on some kind of unspecified legislation to protect us. A few years ago, a BBC colleague of mine asked Geoffrey Sturgis, a laconic and worldly wise franchise lawyer, to review the sub-postmaster's contract for a TV piece we were making. Geoffrey had a good read of it before stating on camera it was unfair. He caveated this by saying that being unfair is par for the course with this type of contract. What's unusual, he noted, is the really unfair way in which the post office enforces it. Pre-Horizon, the sub-postmaster-post office relationship worked on a combination of trust, the threat of penalties, and the expectation of mutual benefit. Sub-postmasters had to keep tabs on the cash that came into and went out of their branches. They filled in their own accounts, signed them, and sent them to the post office for examination. There are strong disincentives to filing false accounts. It's a criminal offence. Horizon, when it came, subtly adjusted the dynamic between the post office and sub-postmaster by inserting a third party into it. Horizon didn't just combine a branch's till transactions and accounts, it took control of them. This was not acknowledged by the post office. Certainly, the sub-postmaster's contract was not redrawn to reflect it. The 152-page version I have from 2002, which is the 1994 version with a lot of extra rules front-loaded onto it, acknowledges Horizon only in passing. Tracy is sent to prison. The post office's investigators seemed fascinated by Tracy Felstead's family holiday. They said, "Did you pay for everybody to go?" she remembers. Tracy's mum and dad got involved. "We said, right, you can have access to everybody's bank accounts so you can see exactly how people have paid for the holiday and where the money's come from." The investigators were not satisfied. 3 weeks later, at the end of April 2001, Tracy was sacked. She was charged by the post office's criminal prosecutors with theft and false accounting because, as she said, my signature was on the paperwork. Tracy's solicitor was unamused. The post office investigators had no evidence of theft. The prosecution didn't make sense. Although Tracy was devastated, she remembers thinking things would work out. The post office would realise its mistake and drop the charges. Or if the worst happened, the justice system would allow her to prove her innocence. Word of the prosecution leaked into the local community. Tracy found herself the victim of a whispering campaign. Family friends, like the guy who got me the job, his family refused to talk to me. They just totally ignored me. And I had people looking at me as if I was a thief. You know, she's done this. Tracy's self-belief began to crumble alarmingly quickly. The only way to explain it is that you're in a black hole. You feel trapped, suffocated. I couldn't understand how anyone could think I would steal anything. My mental health, my whole life took a hit. I was a bubbly girl. I would go out. I had a decent life. I enjoyed life. And then all of a sudden, I didn't want to go out. Things escalated. Because I had time on my hands, because I wasn't working, because I'd been dismissed, I got stuck in a rut. The more I was indoors and the more my mind wasn't occupied, the more frantic I became. Tracy went to see her GP, who prescribed Prozac antidepressants. They didn't work. Over the summer of 2001, Tracy tried to kill herself. I didn't want to have to answer questions I couldn't answer. I didn't want people to see me. I didn't want to go to court. The stigma was very strong. I didn't want to feel like that. I wanted me back. I wanted to be me again. And I didn't feel I was me. I just wanted to die. Tracy took an overdose in her room. She was found by a friend while she was still conscious and rushed to hospital, where she had her stomach pumped. A few weeks later, Tracy took another overdose. I thought, I can't deal with this anymore. I can't cope. I just didn't want to be alive. I didn't want to feel the pain. Alone in the house, Tracy slipped out of consciousness. By luck, her fiancé, John, came home early from work and found her. She was rescued by the emergency services again. This time, she was not sent home, but committed to a secure psychiatric unit at the Princess Royal Hospital in Bromley. Tracy was given intensive psychotherapy treatment and responded well. But once she was out, she had to deal with the reality of being prosecuted. Tracy was not a well woman, but the post office clearly felt it was important to nail her. First, there was a hearing at Guildford Magistrates Court, where Tracy pleaded not guilty to both theft and false accounting. Then came the 3-day trial in front of a jury at Kingston Crown Court. Tracy was a wreck. She remembers shivering in the dock as she watched the trial happen around her. She can't recall much about what was said, but she remembers a point that came up during her cross-examination. Basically, they were saying you did take the money, your signature's there, it's your till, you've taken the money. I said, I went to the manager and explained, and I was told it would be okay. But it didn't seem like they wanted to listen. I couldn't answer the prosecution's questions because I didn't know what had happened. Tracy was convicted by a majority verdict. I was just in disbelief. I just couldn't believe what I was hearing, she said. Tracy wasn't sentenced immediately. Because of her fragile mental state and previous suicide attempts, the judge wanted psychiatric reports completed. Without Tracy's knowledge, her family were also told if they paid the post office the missing £11,000, a prison sentence was less likely. Between Tracy's family and John's parents, they raised the total and handed it over. When John's mum told Tracy, she hit the roof. I said, why are you paying them something I haven't taken? They were trying to save me, but I was so strong-willed, I thought people would see it as a sign of guilt. On her sentencing date, Tracy was told by the judge that she was a liar and that she'd stolen money from pensioners and she'd disgraced her family. Tracy was invited to apologise. She refused. I said in court, I'm not saying sorry for something I haven't done. I'm not saying sorry because I haven't done anything wrong. The judge decided this lack of remorse required a custodial sentence and sent her to prison for 6 months. Tracy's father had to watch his daughter being led from the dock to the cells in handcuffs. I was absolutely petrified, remembers Tracy. Petrified. My barrister came and saw me. He said something's not right, but I don't know how to prove it. We didn't know how to prove it. We almost didn't know how to defend ourselves, in a way. Because we got these big guys, and they're saying, well, you sign that piece of paper and use that till, and it's a discrepancy, and you're the only one that uses that till, and blah, 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 blah. And as much as you can say, well, no, actually I wasn't. Other people use that till as well. And they just didn't want to listen. On the 20th of June, 2002, Tracy was taken away in an armoured van to HMP Holloway. She was put on suicide watch. I was in a high-security prison at the age of 19. I walked in. You go through all the protocol. You've got to strip. You've got to be searched. As with all new inmates, Tracy was brought before the prison governor. I sat down, and I was obviously very, very distraught because they had to give me medication to calm me down. And he said to me, what are you doing here? A girl like you shouldn't be here. Tracy was assigned to a cell, but she was not allowed to be left on her own. She became even more desperate listening to the tales of prisoners who'd murdered people. And with people like, it's their home, if that makes sense. You listen to their stories and you think, oh my goodness, this is all they've got. They actually go out and reoffend because that's all they've got. One afternoon, Tracy walks into a cell to find the body of a girl who'd hanged herself. She began to have nightmares. There were fights, people screaming like they're going to kill someone. Tracy spent 3 months in Holloway. On the day of her release, John and her parents were waiting outside. I got in the car and I remember I was shaking. John gave me my engagement ring back and I put it on my finger. I'd lost a tremendous amount of weight, and all I wanted to do, I just needed to get home. When I got in, I was conscious about the door going. I said, don't close the door. And still, to this day, I can't have doors closed in my house, because it takes me back to that sound of the prison door slamming. Tracy spent the next 20 years battling the mental health repercussions of her experience. In 2020, the post office admitted her prosecution was an abusive process. The following year, the Court of Appeal ruled it was more than that. It was an affront to the entire justice system and should never have happened. In the 4 years leading up to the rollout of the Horizon system, the post office prosecuted 52 sub-postmasters or post office staff for shortfall-related offences. In the 4 years after the rollout, the number more than quadrupled to 220. No one outside the post office queried this leap in prosecution activity because no one was aware of it. The post office was not required to publish its numbers. Tracy Felstead was not the only Crown Office worker to be prosecuted using Horizon evidence. Horizon was, of course, capable of going wrong in Crown offices, the same as it was everywhere else, but Crown Office employees had more protection. Managers could use their discretion to park small discrepancies in a suspense account, and the business would swallow the loss. If large discrepancies arose in a Crown office, as in Tracy's case, things would get serious. But as the years went on, the Communication Workers Union, which represented directly employed Crown Office staff, learned to take a sceptical view of any allegation which relied solely on Horizon data. Horizon's real killing fields were out in the branch sub-post offices, where a different union operated, the National Federation of Sub-Postmasters. The NFSP. Years ago, when I first started digging into this story, I needed to find some independent evidence there was a problem with Horizon. I was speaking to a small number of sub-postmasters with harrowing stories, but most of them had criminal convictions. It was all very well me believing they might be telling the truth, but without compelling documentary evidence, the case for a BBC investigation was weak. especially as most viewers could walk into their local post office and see this supposedly dysfunctional Horizon IT system working without any problems. I had no paperwork or independent witnesses. I also had flat denials from the post office. A journalist who's met someone with a story to tell will often seek information from a variety of sources before approaching their commissioning editor. If the story is a complaint about industrial malpractice, a quick phone call to one of the trade unions operating in that sector can throw up useful contextual information. The complainant might be raising something a union is already alive to, or believes is symptomatic of a wider problem. Unions act like canaries down a coal mine, bringing issues or potential issues to the attention of management. If management isn't interested, a union might go to the media, either as part of a campaign or through individual officials briefing their contacts. So what of the Postmasters Union, the National Federation of Sub-Postmasters? As befits a membership comprised of people who are not traditional employees, the NFSP, otherwise known as the Fed, is not a traditional union. It's more like a rotary club than anything else, a rival union rep once explained to me. They seem to be far more interested in holding annual dinners and congratulating each other than doing much else. That could be unfair both to the Fed and rotary clubs, but I could see what he was getting at. Unlike stereotypical union activists, postmasters do not see themselves as oppressed shop floor workers who want to fight management. They want to be management. They are employers themselves, entrepreneurial, self-reliant, small-c conservatives who instinctively trust officialdom and state institutions. Although they expect their membership body to look after their interests, sub-postmasters want their relationship with the post office to be understood as a partnership of equals. It's a self-image the NFSP likes to reflect and project, and one the post office is only too happy to take advantage of. The key and fatal word in all of this is pride. In 1996, the NFSP's then General Secretary Colin Baker posed for photographs in front of a post office branch in Stroud. He was standing alongside the Secretary of State for Business, Peter Lilly, and the Post Office Managing Director, Stuart Sweetman. There were smiles all round. The three men had set up this PR opportunity to announce a vastly ambitious scheme to put a networked computer system into every post office branch in the country. It was presented as a silver bullet, which would future-proof every postmaster's business and income for decades. Automation would not only accommodate proposed changes to the way government benefits were delivered, but it would open up a lucrative world of digital versatility. Banking, bill payments, product sales, and cost efficiencies were all within reach. It was the deal of the century, and the NFSP were at the very heart of it, selling the network to members at national and regional conferences, promising a golden future. "I cannot help but be optimistic," murmured a dewy-eyed Baker. Members, he said, were gazing at a new dawn, a new horizon, clever, unfurling before our eyes. The scope for new business is probably as wide as our imagination. The post office, with the full support of the NFSP, had bet the farm on Horizon. It could not fail. Protecting the credibility, integrity, and operability of the Horizon system was therefore paramount. From day one of Horizon's rollout, the NFSP refused to countenance any public criticism of the system. To do so could undermine confidence in the post office network and its ability to attract new business. As the post office went on its prosecution spree, any journalist approaching the NFSP would be told in language strikingly similar to the post office's that Horizon was robust. Requests for off-the-record steers about potentially unsafe convictions were met with dark hints that the individuals concerned might well be spinning a yarn. Conversations of that nature can have a chilling effect on the publication of any story, especially if the people bringing it to the journalists' attention had pleaded guilty to the crimes they were now saying they hadn't committed. When I was investigating this story for the first time in late 2010, I'd already been warned by campaigners that the NFSP was worse than useless. My colleagues at the BBC approached them directly. They were sent the following statement. We have complete confidence in the Horizon system, which carries out hundreds of millions of transactions every week at 12,000 post office outlets across the country. The NFSP has seen no evidence to suggest that Horizon has been at fault. We believe it to be robust, as does Post Office Limited, with whom we have regular discussions on the system. The Post Office has never been slow to weaponise the NFSP's position, telling us in their statement to the same programme, the National Federation of Subpostmasters, which vigorously represents the views and interests of subpostmasters around the entire country, has gone on record on a number of occasions to express its full confidence in the accuracy and robustness of the Horizon system. The message could not be clearer. If you don't believe what we're saying about Horizon, talk to the organisation which exists solely to represent its members' interests. That's not to say the NFSP was entirely supine. On the ground, the picture could be different. Individual area reps would travel to meet suspended sub-postmasters and act as a sounding board or advocate during formal interviews. Some would be as bad as the executive. Many postmasters believe their reps actively connived with post office managers. Others would try to push the issue up the chain to a local branch secretary, who may or may not have tried to assist. In the main, though, from the experiences related to me by almost every single former postmaster I've spoken to, any postmaster raising the issue of Horizon as a potential source of their discrepancies was told by their NFSP rep to forget it and think of some other reason they might be losing cash. The decision taken by the NFSP to avoid voicing any public concerns or criticism of Horizon is beyond reprehensible. It made the Fed complicit in the misery and chaos that became the Post Office Horizon IT scandal. Over the next two decades, desperate sub-postmasters, under threat of prosecution or losing their livelihoods, would look to the NFSP for help. Having put its faith in the Horizon system to protect the wider interests of the network, the NFSP publicly cut those sub-postmasters loose and let them drown. Noel Thomas. Anglesey is a famously wild and beautiful island which sits just off the northwestern coast of Wales, linked in two places across the Menai Strait by road and rail bridge to the mainland. Its northern peninsula points like a finger across the Irish Sea towards Belfast, but the island's main ferry links are with Dublin. The Irish capital city lies directly west, 60 miles across the water. Anglesey's main industries are tourism and agriculture. It remains a Welsh language stronghold. Noel Thomas was an Anglesey lad, born and bred. He left school at 15 and in 1963 went to work at the marine yard in Holyhead. After a few adventures, he returned home to the tiny village of Bodorgan on the southwestern side of the island, joining the Royal Mail as a postman on the 6th of June 1965. Noel became a fixture in Bodorgan and nearby Mathtraith, riding 17 miles a day on his post office bike, delivering letters and parcels to his neighbours. He married his sweetheart, Ira, and over the next few years the couple had three children. In 1976, when the postmaster in Mathtraith retired, Noel spotted an opportunity. Noel's parents ran Mathtraith village stores, where they were helped by Ira. He suggested Ira apply to be the new sub-postmaster and install a post office counter in his parents' shop. Noel's round was usually done by midday, so he could help out in the afternoons. The plan was a success. Ira and Noel became the centre of another tight-knit, happy community. The couple's young sons were known in Bodorgan and Mathtraith as Posty and Stamp. Noel and Ira's daughter, Sian, became Sian Post. I got to know Noel much later in life. He's a good old boy who likes company, and being Welsh, singing. He's also a very open and emotional man, who cares a great deal about his family and the community around him. In 1981, a bigger post office in Gairwen, 7 miles up the road from Mathtraith, became available, and the Thomases made their move. For the first 13 years in Gaiawen, Ira was the sub-postmaster, while Noel continued as a postie. In 1994, Noel took on the postmaster's job and Ira switched to managing the shop. By this time, Noel had been a county councillor for 8 years. He was becoming known and respected, not just by his local community, but across the island. Horizon arrived at Gaiawen in 2000. 6 months before it was installed, Noel was sent to the Victoria Hotel in Llanberis near Mount Snowdon. He was the youngest of 6 postmasters who'd gathered for 3 days training on the new machines. Noel had no IT experience of any kind. The other sub-postmasters were well into their 60s, he remembers, and they all packed up except me. They decided to retire before Horizon came to their post offices. Couldn't be dealing with it, you see. Noel describes himself as a pen and paper man. But at the age of 53, he was too young to retire, and Horizon was not optional for his or anyone else's post office. Noel's trainers promised they'd visit him on site to help bed the system in, and they did on 3 separate occasions. Nonetheless, the switch from analogue to digital at Gaiawen Post Office was a culture shock. From the moment it was installed, Noel appears to have been engaged in a mutually antipathetic war of attrition with his new computer terminal. I asked what he didn't like about it. As soon as you press the button, he replied, your work had gone, before you could go back into your paperwork and look over it. But once that button had been pressed, you couldn't get anything back, you had no hard copy. Noel told me he couldn't get the system to generate automatic paper receipts for every transaction, which made it easy to lose track of things. And that's when the kit worked. When serving customers, Noel's screen would regularly freeze mid-transaction. Sometimes the freeze became a crash, necessitating a complete reboot. The power supply to the terminal was prone to cutting out. Even when Horizon was functioning as it should, it was laggy and slow. Noel regularly called the post office Horizon helpline. The helpline notes for the Gaiawen branch acknowledged data transfer interrupts and several remote rebootings. In December 2001, the entire base unit was taken out and replaced. Even when the hardware was working, Noel had a tough time balancing his books. Before 2005, Horizon trading periods were weekly. After closing up on a Wednesday, sub-postmasters would count the cash in the safe and till trays and then tot up the stamps, tax discs, traveller's cheques and other cash-value products. They would then manually enter all denominations, cheques and other values into the relevant boxes on the Horizon screen. Horizon would reconcile the sub-postmaster's data entries with their weekly transactions and deliver a figure which, in an ideal world, would match the total amount of cash and stock on hand in the branch. It was post office policy that every branch had to balance to zero before it started the next trading period. If you did manage to balance to zero, that is, Horizon's figures matched your cash and stock exactly, congratulations, you could go to bed. If they didn't, you had a problem. Although very few sub-postmasters were ever told this, Horizon would actually let you roll a discrepancy over into the next trading period, but it didn't like it. Sub-postmasters attempting to do so would get a screen warning that this was against procedure and they should not be doing it. If a sub-postmaster went ahead and did it anyway, an electronic red flag would be raised on the post office's systems. Before long, HQ, likely via a regional manager, would be onto you, requiring you to make good the discrepancy before the end of the next trading period. If you had a surplus, you were contractually allowed to keep it. Most sub-postmasters kept their surpluses in the safe or in an unders and overs tin. Like sensible business people, they knew surpluses didn't appear out of thin air and were likely to be cancelled out somewhere along the line. If the balance was negative by a few quid, a sub-postmaster might take that few quid out of the retail till or the unders and overs tin and make good the difference. If a sub-postmaster was, say, more than £10 out of line, it might be time to start thinking about recounting the cash and stock, or going back through the paperwork, looking for duplicate transactions or miskeyed entries. The latter was always a potential issue on a touchscreen. For instance, on Horizon, the double zero button is located right next to the zero button. Screen misalignments, fat fingers, and hurried counter-assistants entering a £50 payment as £500 could cause a £450 discrepancy with one keystroke. Depending on ability, the number of counter-assistants, usually each with their own login, and the number of transactions over the course of a week at any given branch, basic mistakes were relatively easy to find. To assist with locating possible sources of error, Horizon's rudimentary report writing, printed on the same 3.5-inch till roll used to deliver customer receipts, was available to sub-postmasters who knew how to use it. If a sub-postmaster checked their transactions, recounted their cash, and still had a discrepancy, or they'd forgotten what to do, or didn't know how to use a piece of Horizon functionality, they could call the Horizon helpline. More on that later. Despite finding things an uphill struggle, Noel slowly got to grips with Horizon. Over time, the more obvious hardware problems seemed to stabilise, but some accounting discrepancies could not be traced. They built up. By 2003, Noel had £6,000 sitting in his branch suspense account. A Horizon branch suspense account was, on the face of it, a sensible solution for dealing with inexplicable discrepancies. If, like Noel, a sub-postmaster had a sum missing from their branch accounts and they couldn't find the source of that discrepancy, they had options. They could shrug their shoulders and make good the discrepancy themselves from their own savings or retail takings, but no sub-postmaster liked doing that, especially if they knew the discrepancy was nothing to do with them or their assistants. The other option was to put the discrepancy into a local suspense account, that is, lift it out of the weekly figures and park it somewhere to be investigated. This had to be done with the authority of an area manager or the post office suspense account team. But what happened then? Who was responsible for that discrepancy? The sub-postmaster or the post office? The post office was not obliged to investigate the cause of the discrepancy, and sub-postmasters were only responsible if the discrepancy was down to their carelessness, negligence or error. After a few years of Horizon's operation, branch suspense accounts up and down the country were filled with disputed discrepancies. The sums involved were growing by the thousand. The post office was leaning on sub-postmasters to make the discrepancies good, with some success. The threat of being sacked for refusing was an effective motivator. But many sub-postmasters were refusing to accept responsibility for gaps in branch accounts, which they were certain had nothing to do with them. It was becoming a real headache for both sub-postmasters and the post office. In 2005, the post office came up with an elegant solution. It removed the branch suspense account option from Horizon. Sub-postmasters could no longer park discrepancies in suspense. They had to accept discrepancies as debts. Great for the post office, not so good for sub-postmasters. Under the post-2005 regime, the Horizon terminal screen presented a postmaster with two choices to settle a discrepancy. They could either press the button marked Settle to Cash or Check, which meant the postmaster had made good the discrepancy immediately, or they could press Settle Centrally, which acknowledged the debt was the sub-postmaster's, but to be paid at a later date. The sub-postmaster could then call the helpline to contest their debt. Once the post office had done as much or as little investigation it felt was necessary, it would either issue an error notice, later called a transaction correction, to rebalance the books, effectively acknowledging the error was at the post office end, or require the sub-postmaster to make good the discrepancy via a debt notice. Not to worry. Not knowing what to do with the £6,000 discrepancy he'd been allowed to put in suspense, Noel called in the post office. The regional head manager came up to see me with my line manager, and we sorted it out in our back room, Noel told me. It was settled between us, half and half. For a man earning little more than £24,000 a year, swallowing a £3,000 loss was hard. Noel hoped that would be the end of it, but it wasn't. Inexplicable discrepancies began to build once more. Each week, the gap between the figures on Noel's Horizon screen and reality grew wider. Noel knew that if he raised the issue with his area manager again, he could be held liable for at least half his discrepancy, if not all of it. Noel continued to call the helpline, but neither rolled his losses over into the next weekly accounting period, because that was not allowed, nor sought permission to put them into suspense, because he'd seen how that ended. Instead, he signed off Horizon's figures, effectively agreeing that the number on the screen matched the value of cash and stock in the Garwin branch. Noel was later to discover the post office considered this to be falsifying accounts, making him liable for a criminal charge of false accounting. I asked Noel why he decided to sign off Horizon figures which didn't match his cash and stock, rather than go back to management to explain his concerns. At the time, there was this big splurge of closing post offices, he said, and I didn't want to lose my post office. I didn't want the village to lose its post office. And when I did tell the helpline about the problems, they told me to carry on. It would be sorted out by them. Ah, the helpline. In a scandal notable for lamentable failings at almost every level, the helpline's role as a facilitator of chaos within the post office network has probably not even now been fully appreciated. The helpline, or as it became known, the hell line, was the first point of contact for a frazzled sub-postmaster who'd gone from serving customers behind their counter all day to working their way through a 10-foot-long strip of receipt paper trying to understand why they might be £60, £600 or £6,000 out of pocket. The advice sub-postmasters got from the helpline had a huge bearing on the decisions they took. Given it was coming directly from a representative of the post office, they could be forgiven for acting on it. Unfortunately, the helpline was understaffed, which made it difficult to get through, and the staff were undertrained. When Horizon came in, the first-line support operators knew little more about the system than the sub-postmasters themselves. Sub-postmasters who were having obvious technical problems, screen freezes, printer failures and the like, would be referred by the helpline to technical support, run by Fujitsu. Fujitsu might arrange for a hardware swap-out or a visit from an engineer. If the concern was thought to be more process or accounting-driven, sub-postmasters would be diverted to a post office support team representative who would attempt to either talk them through the necessary screens and buttons or offer advice. If the telephone support provided by the post office couldn't help with a problem, a visit by a trainer or area manager might be arranged. If it became apparent what had looked like an accounting or process issue might actually be a software issue, that is, Horizon wasn't working properly, the post office or Fujitsu technical support could put a sub-postmaster through to specialist technical support. Software Support Centre, run out of Fujitsu headquarters in Bracknell, dealt with complicated hardware issues, software errors and bugs. They could do anything from writing individual fixes to rolling out estate-wide software patches. When necessary, they could access a branch terminal remotely by taking it over and diving into it. Sometimes, a sub-postmaster would be put through to a post office helpline operator who didn't know enough about the system to diagnose a problem properly. The operator might suggest trying a few things. This occasionally ended up making a situation worse, not just more confusing, but materially worse by increasing a negative discrepancy. If the sub-postmaster was then unable to reverse the action taken, many have said they were told that they were liable for the now larger discrepancy. Another common helpline nugget was telling sub-postmasters not to worry, because the problem a caller was facing would sort itself out, which is what Noel says he was told. Sometimes this advice came with a suggestion to balance to zero, in other words, to accept the Horizon discrepancy as an accurate record of cash and stock on hand, despite this not being the case, and then wait for an error notice or transaction correction to be sent to them, rectifying the discrepancy. In 2014, this issue was raised in Parliament, with one MP wondering if advice to balance to zero was a possible example of the post office breaking the law by encouraging its sub-postmasters to false account. This allegation was huffily rejected by the post office. No documentary evidence exists to back the sub-postmasters' claims that they were occasionally encouraged to balance to zero in this way, because the post office, until recently, didn't record calls to its helpline. Noel told me he wasn't worried about the implications of what he was doing, partly because he didn't understand them, and partly because he felt he'd done the right thing and informed his employers of what was going on, using the helpline. Despite what he'd been told, His balancing problems hadn't sorted themselves out. What was he supposed to do? Stop trading? That would reduce the number of customers coming into his shop and put him in breach of the same contract which held him responsible for any losses he couldn't prove weren't his fault. And besides, the village depended on him. In those days, the local post office was an important community resource. Noel now acknowledges he was sleepwalking into something very serious. With the benefit of hindsight, he realises just how big a mistake it was to agree figures which weren't correct. If I'd closed the shop, he said, it would have been better. At the time, Noel blithely carried on accepting whatever weekly figure Horizon threw at him, and so long as no one from the post office noticed, he could carry on trading. On the 13th of October 2005, the post office sprang a surprise audit on the Garwin branch. A discrepancy of £48,000 was recorded. Noel was immediately suspended. During subsequent interviews with post office investigators, Noel was quite upfront about what he'd been doing. He squarely blamed the IT system for what was going wrong. The post office investigators weren't sure. They told him he was the only person who'd been having problems with Horizon. Noel couldn't believe it. Being a big fish in a small pond, Noel's suspension was hot news in Anglesey. I got snide remarks. People would turn their backs. It was hard, he remembers. The gossip intensified in early 2006 when Noel was charged with false accounting and theft. It's not clear on what grounds the post office charged Noel with theft. No evidence has ever been produced to suggest he stole any money at all. The logic appears to have been that £48,000 was missing from the branch, and in the absence of any other explanation, Noel must have stolen it. Noel was aware his situation was serious, but was equally adamant he wasn't guilty of any crime. Mistakes, perhaps, but not a criminal offence. Noel's lawyers took a different view. His interviews with post office investigators had been under caution. Whilst under caution, Noel had admitted to signing off false accounts. If he continued to plead not guilty to an offence he'd admitted under caution, it was a slam dunk for the prosecution, and he would almost certainly go to jail. In the background to this discussion, there was some plea bargaining going on. The post office told Noel's advisers that if he pleaded guilty to false accounting, on a basis which made it clear that no blame was attributed to Horizon, they would drop the theft charge. This could further reduce the likelihood of a prison sentence. Faced with a very real prospect of going to jail, Noel wobbled. He resigned the Plaid Cymru whip on the county council and ceased to be politically active. At his next court hearing, Noel pleaded guilty to false accounting. The post office dropped the theft charge. Noel's sentencing took place at Carnarvon Crown Court on the 6th of November 2006. A local TV news crew was outside court to capture the occasion. Noel packed a bag of belongings, as he'd been advised. In front of his family, who'd come to support him in court, the judge told Noel the matter was so grave, neither a fine nor a community service order is sufficient, and an immediate custodial sentence is appropriate. Noel was given 9 months. He was led away from court in handcuffs to a waiting police van. As he left the building, he briefly looked towards the people gathered on the other side of the courtyard gates. The TV crew got their shot. The slow-motion image of a bewildered 59-year-old man staring forlornly at the camera was broadcast that evening across Wales. Noel was taken to Walton Prison in Liverpool. He's reluctant to talk in specifics about his time there, saying only it was bloody horrible. There were very few people my age in prison. The majority were young people, and they could be pretty rough. Noel's full name is Huey Noel Thomas. He's known as Noel because he was born on Christmas Eve. Noel spent his 60th birthday, the Christmas of 2006, alone in prison as a convicted criminal, prosecuted by the organisation he'd given 42 years of his life to. On his release in 2007, Noel's nightmare continued. The post office succeeded in securing a Proceeds of Crime Act order against him, which allowed them to go after his assets for the supposedly missing £48,000. After handing over his life savings, Noel declared himself bankrupt and went into retirement. He tells me the post office tried to retrieve the outstanding amount from his post office pension. Noel's experience has left him permanently scarred. Long after he served his prison sentence, he would go to bed at night and wake up screaming. Like Tracy Felstead, he still sleeps with his door open and a light on outside. The mystery of what happened at the Gowin branch remains to this day. Was there anything wrong with the Horizon terminals in Noel's branch? Or was he just making basic mistakes? We don't know. After Noel's suspension, the post office removed both the Horizon terminals from Gowin post office. They were handed over to Fujitsu for testing and never seen again. No record of any test results exist. In fact, there's a lot of mystery about what happened to Noel. In 2013, when the post office were asked about the 50-50 deal they cut over Noel's initial £6,000 discrepancy, they were unable to find any record of this. Nor were the post office able to confirm whether or not Noel had received any training. Nor could they produce any evidence of a signed sub-postmaster's contract. Nor were they able to refer to any of the documents they seized from Noel's post office when he was suspended in 2005, including Noel's personal diary detailing his problems with Horizon. Noel says when he asked for them back, he was told they'd been lost in a fire. The sub-postmaster's bind. When attempting to explain this story to broadcast news editors, producers and taxi drivers, there are lots of "but what?" questions. No one really believes innocent people plead guilty, for a start. And no one really thinks an accounting system which consistently concludes 2 plus 2 equals 4 would every now and then decide 2 plus 2 equals 5, or 8. Furthermore, no one believes innocent people would deliberately declare incorrect accounting figures without raising their hands to ask for help. They do, it can, and they did. But understanding how requires some counterintuitive thinking. I realise lengthy explanations can derail a decent narrative, but unless you are fully satisfied, a large IT network can appear to work perfectly well 99.9% of the time, whilst malfunctioning quite seriously elsewhere, let alone accepting the idea that pleading guilty is a better option for an innocent person than pleading not guilty, then you, like my long-suffering newsroom colleagues, will have outstanding questions. First of all, try to put aside the notion that computers are glorified calculators, and instead think of them as complex live ecosystems, reliant on perfect humans, perfect hardware, perfect communication pathways, perfect environments, and perfect software to ensure perfect outcomes. As nothing is perfect, some level of failure or malfunction must therefore be an expected and normal outcome in any IT setup. The larger and more complex the system, the more complex and likely the failure. Where a malfunction manifests and how long it takes to trace the manifestation to the malfunction can affect the operability of a system. If a malfunction is small in proportion to a system's general functionality, its manifestation may be equally small in its overall effect on the system, but disproportionately large in its consequence for an end user. Every 1,000 lines of computer code is known as a K-log. K signifies 1,000, and LOC stands for lines of code. A piece of commercial software is considered good if it contains 0.5 to 1 errors per K-log. The more K-logs, the more errors. Modern software applications run to several thousand K-logs. If a plane's computer software has one tiny bug in it, a dodgy line of source code amongst the thousands of K-logs, and if certain inputs, for example, sensor information, combined with a pilot instruction inputted via specific interfaces within a specific time frame at, say, a specific altitude, activate a routine containing that dodgy line of code, the plane's safety systems, also obviously running on code, might flag up a problem. Or the routine might cause the plane to do something unexpected. or both. To respond, a pilot can input further instructions. But if the code implementing those further instructions has one dodgy line in it, and is now trying to override an instruction in some code which isn't itself doing what it should, the new instruction could fail, or have the opposite intended effect, or not be told it's succeeding. Planes rarely fall out of the sky just because of dodgy lines of code. In 2019, two Boeing 737 MAX crashes led to the worldwide grounding of the 737 MAX fleet. The crashes were not caused by bugs in source code, but by fundamental errors in the software design, which, when combined with sensor failures in specific circumstances, caused disaster. These were bad back-end inputs at a different level to coding inputs, but they were bad inputs, which had terrible outputs. In this case, pilots not being in control of what they were flying. Horizon's source code was never written or tested to anywhere near the same standard as the safety-critical systems which keep planes in the air. It was also not a closed system. Multiple back-end inputs meant Horizon continually evolved. Security or product upgrades and software patches were written and released to fix, enhance, or protect elements of the network. These were being introduced by imperfect humans on a weekly basis. These upgrades could change the data on the system, where it was being sent, and what happened when it interacted with something else. Not all the upgrades and fixes were fully tested before being released. To do so would be too expensive. As a result, not all of them worked, and some of them caused odd problems in unexpected places. Between 1999 and 2019, Fujitsu changed the software code which operated Horizon on 19,842 separate occasions, roughly equivalent to 1,000 different changes per year. Subpostmasters were essentially using a slightly different computer system almost every time they logged in, and a different system might react to the same button pushes in slightly different ways. Much of the new data swirling around the network each upgrade will have been small script changes and bug fixes. But every now and then, a new Horizon version was uploaded. These had exciting names like SO6, S10, and B11. In April 2003, Horizon version S30 was released by Fujitsu. It had not been properly tested, and it introduced a bug known as the reversal bug. If a subpostmaster inputted a series of transactions and then for some reason wanted to cancel them, the transactions would have to be reversed out of Horizon. The reversal bug appeared to reverse a transaction, but in fact doubled it. This was due to a plus sign in the code, which should have been a minus sign. The reversal bug was discovered by Fujitsu after some postmasters began to complain about the growing amount of non-existent money Horizon calculated as being in their accounts at the end of the week. When one sub-postmaster reversed an internal £13,910 cash transfer out of one stock unit and into another, he managed to create a £27,820 negative discrepancy in his accounts. Initially, Fujitsu engineers...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.